Hill Baptist Church. Let's stand to our feet and praise the Lord again. Let's sing, here we go. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth?
Come on.
With holy thunder, he leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing. Continue to worship him. I'm gonna raise a hallelujah this morning. Here we go. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. Oh, I raise a hallelujah. Louder than the unbelief.
This next song is based in the book of Daniel, and I want to set the stage here. So the king Nebuchadnezzar has issued a decree that all people would bow down and worship him, and three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, refuse. And the king goes into a furious rage. He orders that they be thrown into the fire, and the king orders that the furnace be turned up seven times hotter than it usually is. So hot to the point that the men that throw them into the fire are killed as they're executing that duty. And so they fall into the fire, and King Nebuchadnezzar looks, and he sees, and he says, "Didn't we throw three men in the fire? But look, there are four walking around, and the fourth looks like a son of the gods." So when God calls you to walk in obedience, God is not going to leave you. God walks with you. God protects you. God fights for you. God is with you. So we're going to continue to worship just in that spirit of victory. God is with you even here today.
There's a grace when the heart is undefiled. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the sea. Should I ever need reminding how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. All my dead left for dead beneath the water.
We love you today. We praise you that you are the God who is with us. You are with us through the fire. Lord, you are so good to us. You are so faithful no matter what we're going through. And we just pray that here today you would remind us of that wonderful truth. God, you are here with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all may be seated.
Welcome, church family. It is so good to have you this morning worshiping with us. Jesus said, "I am here that you may have life and have it more abundantly." And that is the promise that we're talking about in our new sermon series, Possessing the Promise. Here at PBC, we want to help you with your next steps to move you toward that abundant spiritual life. Hey kids, I have something new for you this week. Each week we tell you it's time to go to your leaders, but we're going to try something a little bit different. Starting in August, when you see this box at the bottom of the screen, this will be your signal to go to the lobby and meet your leaders. Are you ready to try it? Experiencing the abundant life is all about living a lifestyle where you continually know God, find freedom, discover your purpose and God's purpose, and make a difference. Our way to share this with you is in Growth Track on Sunday, July 18th from 4 to 7 p.m. You get to meet the pastors and share in a wonderful meal and find all about PVC and our vision here. Childcare is provided for 5th grade and under, so if you want to join us, text GROWTH to the PVC text number and register today. If you're not quite ready for Growth Track yet, stop by our Next Steps table at the front of the sanctuary. Our team would like to meet you and tell you a little bit more about PVC and help you take the next steps with us here at PVC. Oh, and I heard that they have a gift just for stopping by. Have you tried texting Pray For Me yet? If you have a prayer need or a request that you'd like for us and our prayer warriors to be praying for, text Pray For Me to our PVC text number and we'll get our prayer warriors and we'll be praying for it right away. The best week of summer is just 3 weeks away. Windshape Camp. And it's going to start August 2nd. And if you remember last time, it was awesome. So there's three ways that we need your help to make this an awesome event. First, we need volunteers to be host for each of our groups. The second way you can help is you can provide a scholarship or two or three, however you want, for a kid to come. To get to help in either of these ways, go to perbap.org/windshape and you can do everything online. Now there's also a third way to help. It's with supplies. Stop by the supply sign in the lobby and pick out a supply that you can bring and you can help us out that way. One of the qualities that I love most about PBC is the heart to be a kingdom-minded church in a way that reaches far beyond the walls of our building. One of the ways we hope to invest in the kingdom is to grant experience to these residents that will be launched into varying roles in ministry across the world. I want to introduce to you our three residents.
Yo, what's up, guys? I'm the high school resident.
Hey, guys, I'm Bethany, and I'm the middle school resident.
Hi, everyone. I'm Morgan, and I'm going to be the elementary resident.
Henry is going to be working with Dwell 912, our 9th grade to 12th grade ministry. Bethany is going to be working with Dwell 68, which is our 6th grade through 8th grade ministry. And Morgan is going to be helping with PBC Elementary. Be sure to welcome them, encourage them, and be praying for them. Your support will allow their work in the ministry to thrive here at our church.
All right. Good morning, church. I'm so glad that you're here. I know we've got a couple of our residents here, and we didn't prep them for this, but we're going to call them out anyways. You guys have already met Henry, but Henry, just so that they can see you again, would you stand up? Bethany, would you stand up? Would you guys welcome our residents that are coming to hang out with us? We're going to have a Meet the Residents event coming up here pretty soon, so be on the lookout for that, and come and introduce yourself to them, welcome them. They're going to be hanging out with us for a period of time as they're getting launched off into ministry and getting their feet wet here at PBC. Pastor Kevin was talking about Windshape, and that's coming up in just a few weeks. We do need some volunteers and other ways you can help with scholarships and supplies. I just looked at the end of this last week, and I think there are still 15 to 20 spots. So we've got a limit because of capacity issues, and so we do have a few spots left. I think kindergarten is full, but there's spots all the way up through middle school still available. So if you're new to our church and you've never heard about Windshape, this is what we do. That's kind of a VBS on steroids, on steroids, on steroids. It is an all-day camp. It's $169 for the entire week, and it's incredible. It's a partnership with Chick-fil-A. And they bring in about 28 trained people that are going all over the country right now, and they'll come here at the beginning of August to run Windshape for us. And what we love about Windshape is that it helps us really reach new people in the community. This is not just for our church. Last time we did this, which was 2 years ago, We had 25% of the kids that came were not churched kids. They didn't go to church anywhere. And we love that. Because it teaches and preaches the gospel, and this is an awesome opportunity. And so if you know people that are looking for stuff to do with their kids this summer and don't go to church anywhere, make sure you invite them. They can go to our website, find the link for it there, and it is an awesome, awesome, awesome week. My kids are wearing me out about it, all right? So wind shape in a few weeks, and then, of course, pray. Just pray leading up to that, that God would work, draw kids' hearts to himself, especially kids that don't go to church and aren't hearing that on a weekly basis, that they would come to know Christ that week as they come and hear the message of the gospel. Well, today we're going to dive back into Joshua, and in case you have missed any of the weeks, and I know we've got a lot of people on vacation this time of the year, so we got more people last week and this week joining us online than normal, and so we want to say thanks for tuning in with us this week, keeping up with where we are and all that's going on, and we're looking forward to having you back when you get back from vacation. We're going to dive back in, and in case you've missed any weeks, let me try to catch us up a little bit. Joshua has taken over command of the Israelites from Moses. They're headed to the Promised Land, which, if you remember, represents not heaven, but it represents the real life that God wants you and I to live, the kind of fulfilled life Jesus talked about in John 10:10. It is a place where we can experience him here on earth. That's what it represents. It's not a place of wandering or a place lacking purpose. It is a place of fulfillment that reverberates for eternity. And that's where they're headed. And as we saw in the New Testament, these things were written down for us as examples. So there's much for us to learn as we walk through Joshua. We talked last week about how Joshua led them across the raging Jordan River. Do you remember that? And they went back and they grabbed the 12 stones out of the middle of the river and they set them up as a memorial to remember God's faithfulness. And the challenge for us was we've all seen God be faithful in our lives, right? And we need to actively and tangibly remember that in our lives. And so I hope you spend some time this week setting up a way to do that. So they've taken their next steps in that direction for that life, and now what? Bible quiz time. You ready? Put your Bible quiz hat on. It's a very easy question here. Does anybody know, after they cross the Jordan, what is the first city they come in contact with? Anybody know? Just shout it out. Jericho, right? Everybody knows Joshua fought the battle. Anybody know that song? Am I alone on this? Please tell me I'm not alone on this. Yeah, Joshua Joshua, I mean, that would have made those battles a lot easier probably, but that's not how that worked back then. Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. And we love the story of Jericho, don't we? It's so good on felt boards. It's so good for VBS. It's so good for children's ministry. Did you hear the story about the kid in children's ministry who was asked, who knocked down the walls of Jericho? And the little kid said, I don't know, but it wasn't me. You ever heard that? And then the teacher went and told his mom what he said, and she says, listen, if Johnny said he didn't do it, okay? Leave him alone, right? And the teacher went to the dad and was trying to explain. She was really confused. She went and she was explaining the situation to the dad, and he, you know, was a little flustered, like he's seen this story before, and he says, listen, I don't want any trouble. How much does the wall cost? You know? You heard that story? So we love the story of Jericho, right? This is a familiar story for us, but before we can go and knock down those walls, there is a very delicate matter that must be taken care of first. And people who know what chapter is coming are already giggling. Turn in your Bibles to Joshua chapter 5, and we're going to dig into God's Word here today. Joshua chapter 5. God, as we open up your Word, I pray, God, that you would speak to us through it, that you'd show us how you want us to grow and to change. And we thank you for your Word, how it is living and active for today, how it is true and we can trust it. And I pray, God, that as we read it, we would read it as the truth, not a suggestion, but the truth for our lives. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Joshua chapter 5, verse 1. It says this. It says, as soon as all the kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan to the west and all the kings of the Canaanites who were by the sea heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of the Jordan, that's what we talked about last week, for the people of Israel until they'd crossed over, look what happens, their hearts melted and there was no longer any spirit in them because of the people of Israel. Now, fear of the Israelites and the God of the Israelites has been building long before the Jordan crossing. A few chapters ago, you'll remember, Joshua sent some spies into the land to check it out. This was when the spies came in contact with Rahab. And Rahab told them this back in Joshua 2. She said, "We've heard of how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea." That was 40 years before. Before you, when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, look what happened. Sounds familiar, right? Our hearts melted, and there was no spirit left in any man because of you. Doesn't that sound familiar? For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth below. Fear of the Israelites has been growing for quite some time. Their hearts had melted 40 years before when they heard about the Israelites crossing the Red Sea headed in their direction, right? So they heard about it then, and now we're seeing it again. God's done it again for the nation of Israel, who stands millions strong at this point. They've come across the Jordan River, and they stood right outside of their cities with this great river and sea controlling God on their side, and their hearts melted again. Now, just curious, if you cause someone's heart to melt, do you think that you should be cardiac arrested? Like, I think that's what ought to happen to you. I'm telling you, I need to go to school for these and make them better. This wasn't Indiana Jones heart-melting kind of stuff here, right? You remember that in the Temple of Doom? This is not what was happening here. The phrase "for their hearts melted" literally meant deep discouragement. Their hearts melted like they skipped a beat, like something really shocking just happened to them, like my wife's response the first time she saw me. Like, that's the kind of thing that... She's not in here, is she? That's the kind of thing that happened here, except it was... Well, hopefully not exactly like what happened to my wife. That would be kind of bad. But to the negative, right? Their hearts melted. Has this ever happened to you? Have you ever been so intimidated that you were defeated before it even started? That ever happened to you in your life? It happened to me. One time, I try not to tell you too many running stories because I don't want to bore you to death, and I have too many of them, but I can't help but tell you this story. When I was a freshman in high school, my very first track meet of my freshman year was at a tiny little school called Sulphur Springs. You know where Sulphur Springs is. And we were racing this school there, and I'd had a little bit of success in middle school, and I really thought highly of myself. And if you were here a few weeks ago, by this point in time, I'd gotten a haircut, so the mullet and the sidelines were gone. I had gotten some new clothes. I was really feeling good, right? Ninth grade, starting high school. And this very first race was in Sulphur Springs, and I'd heard about this guy that ran at Sulphur Springs. His name was Kyle King, and Kyle was a senior that year. Kyle had gotten fifth in the state of Texas in the 2 mile the year before, which is a pretty big deal. And so I'm headed to Sulphur Springs into the bus. I'm thinking, like, this is my guy. You know what I mean? Like, I'm going to show up today, right? And so we get out to the track, and the race starts. And I'm looking over. He had bright red hair, so it was totally easy to pick him out of the crowd. And he was a little bit taller than me, and he had his blue jersey on. And I looked over, and I was like, I got this guy, right? Youthful pride. Anyway, so we start the race, and I sprinted. I bolted out of the gun. And around the first curve, by the time we got to the back straightaway on the very first lap, I was in the lead, right? And I'm feeling really, really good. This is my day. And we get to the second curve on the first lap, and I can't hear anybody. Like, and I'm so far ahead already. Like, this race is over on the first lap, you know? And so I can't hear anybody behind me. Normally you can hear, like, the spikes clicking or whatever. And we get kind of the end of the first curve, and this is a perfect time to take a look over your shoulder and see how your competition's doing, right? So I look over my shoulder, and Kyle King, I kid you not, was within like 3 inches of my face. And I was like, oh, Kyle's right there. And the reason I couldn't hear him is because he wasn't breathing hard at all. Like, this was normal for him. And I was straining, and I thought, man, I'm in trouble. And so I kind of make eye contact with him, and I think I flinched. And he says, in a calm voice, as if we were sitting on the couch playing Mario Kart and drinking Surge and just hanging out. How many of you remember Surge? Come on, people. It'll take you back to your childhood here. And this is the 90s, people. And he says to me in a calm voice, like, we're just chilling. Don't look back, boy. You know I'm here. And I died in that moment. Like, it was over. My heart melted. I was defeated. The race was over. Kyle King passed me almost immediately and lapped everyone in the race, literally everyone in the race, okay? I was humbled that day. I'd like to say that was the only time I needed humbling in my life, but unfortunately, that was just the first. You ever had a heart-melting experience like that where, like, suddenly you realized it's over? In Joshua 5, every king and people group and ight in the land was scared. They have seen the power of God on display. And they're thinking, right, if this God can stop a river and wall it up and dry up the ground so much that there's not even mud left, if this God can open the Red Sea and they can walk across, what can he do to us? The enemy was scared. They knew their destruction was about to come to pass. And now let's step into our lives for just a second and think this through. As we look around us, it seems like the enemy is having a heyday around us today, doesn't it? As you look around in our culture, in our country, in our county, and in our community, it looks like the enemy is having a heyday. It's simple to see, right? Because what God calls evil, our world, and the enemy has convinced the world that it's good. We see that all around us. Truth isn't the truth anymore. It is relative for people. Seems like the enemy's having a heyday, doesn't it? Rather than educate, unfortunately, we kind of border on indoctrinate. Things have really gotten to a scary place. And sometimes it can get so overwhelming about the success of the enemy around us that our hearts melt away and we become discouraged. But take heart. The ruler of this world's defeat in 2021 is just as assured as it was over the Canaanite kings in Joshua 5. The same power that held back the water for the Israelites has the power over the enemy today, too. Our Lord fights for us, and victory is assured for us just like it was for them. In fact, it is more complete and more eternal even than the one that they experienced in the book of Joshua. You don't believe me? Here's what the Word of God says about what happened when Jesus came. 1 John 3:8 says this, the reason the Son of God appeared was to, what does that word say? Y'all say it with me because you need to build your faith today. It says, was to destroy the works of the devil. Destroy it. Not to leave even an ounce behind. When Jesus came, he came to destroy the works of the devil. I love it. Hebrews 2:14, read the yellow with me when we get there. Christ himself partook of the same things, talking about flesh and blood, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil. Now look at Colossians 2:15. God disarmed the rulers, you know what to do, and authorities, and he put them to open shame by what? Triumphing over them in him, which is Jesus. This is all true. When Jesus came, he came to destroy the works of the devil, to triumph over him. Our enemy melts because he knows his days are numbered, like Revelation 7 says. Our enemy's days are numbered. And as believers in Jesus Christ, that's where we put our faith, knowing that we know how this story ends. We know how this is going to go. And if you're a believer, and you're looking at how much of an impact the enemy has had on our land, we don't let our hearts melt away. It's his heart that ought to melt away, knowing that the end is assured yet. There is a theme that persists throughout the book of Joshua. God is going to defeat every enemy they face in a most surprising way. And the path to that victory started in the most unexpected way. Look at Joshua chapter 5, verse 2. It says, "At that time, the Lord said to Joshua, 'Make flint knives.'" And if I'm Joshua and I'm hearing this, I'm excited. At that moment, just press pause for just a second. Y'all reading ahead, I know you are. But if I heard the Lord say, "Make flint knives," I'm like McConaughey, "All right, all right, all right. The time has come." Right? The time has come. We're making knives, and it's time to go tackle the enemy. Y'all read ahead, didn't you, even after I said not to? It says, "Make flint knives and circumcise the sons of Israel a second time." You think Joshua's heart melted away? Verses 4 through 7 explain why this was done. What happened is when they left Egypt, they stopped circumcising their boys like God had told them to. And so this entire generation that passed away in the wilderness is gone, and this entire generation that's left have not done what God had told them to do. And so verse 3 says, so Joshua, you got to give this guy some credit for immediate obedience, right? So Joshua made flint knives and circumcised the sons of Israel at Gibeath Haaraloth. What? Like, is this... We're going to go out and defeat the enemy. Their hearts are melted away. And we're going to start like this. Can you imagine this first conversation where Joshua's like, so, this is how God says we're going to defeat the enemy. Who's with me? Right? Now, I want to pause for just a second because I know this can be awkward. It may even be distracting for you. And I heard about a pastor one time, a youth pastor, Pastor Kevin, listen closely, who was preaching on this to the youth group one time. And a young girl in the youth group raised her hand and asked, "What's circumcision?" And this is every youth pastor's like nightmare, okay? I've just got to tell you, it is, right? It is, yeah. And instead of saying what he should have said, which is go home and ask your parents, that's the right answer. Right, Kevin? That's the right answer. Yeah, he's going, yes, amen. That's the right answer. But instead of doing that, this youth pastor, this was his own testimony, this is a true story, he got the bright idea, let Webster tell her. And so he gets a dictionary, and he reads the dictionary definition of what it is. And the youth pastor said the girl never came back to youth group after that day. Like, poor girl's innocence was removed right there in that moment. You know, I found as I was studying through this passage, I found that most preachers and most scholars actually skip this passage. They do, really. You ought to go look, right? Go look it up. You won't find many sermons on it, and you won't find a whole lot of scholars writing about it because it's difficult. And I just want you to know, just to reaffirm to you, we are a Bible-believing, Bible-preaching, and by God's grace, a Bible-doing church. We don't skip hard passages, okay? That's what we do. But I can understand the temptation. Totally get it. So I just want to invite you to step past the awkward with me and don't miss the message here, okay? The Israelites have been promised victory over their enemies. The enemy is running scared. Their hearts have melted away. And this seems, if I am a military commander, like the most strategic time to take this army that at this point in time, they'll be numbered soon, are in the hundreds of thousands. So this sounds like the perfect time to take my army and go and crush the enemy. Go rout them, right? Strike them while their spirits are crushed and victory is sure. Moving forward in confidence and courage, knowing that you're going to win. And by the way, I believe this is how a lot of believers respond at this time. We read those verses like in Hebrews 2 and in Colossians 2, and we know that victory is assured, and many of us at that moment get ready to go and conquer the enemy. But notice what the Bible says. Every word matters. It says, at that time, when the enemy's hearts were melted, when it would be the most strategic, militaristic time to go and attack them, at that time. Imagine the setting here. Don't imagine the scene. That's gross. Imagine the setting here. Imagine what's happening. They're on the enemy's side of the river. this rushing river that was very hard for people to cross. This would have been a whole lot easier to take care of on the other side of the river. They're on the enemy's side of the river, and unless God opens the river up again, they're kind of stuck, okay? So they're on the enemy's side of the river, and they could have taken care of it, not just on the other side, but if they'd been obedient, they could have taken care of it back in the wilderness where healing would have been a whole lot easier when they were babies. Instead, they're going to be incapacitated for who knows how long. And think of this. The Canaanites and the Amorites and all of their enemies knew that they had crossed the Red Sea on dry ground 40 years before. All of them knew that they had crossed the Jordan River on dry ground just days before. They know this. And you got to ask the question, how did they know? Either somebody was watching or at least someone is reporting what's happening. Don't you think if you're the Israelites, you're thinking, we really could have done this for Pete's sake out of sight of our enemy? That would have been a whole lot better. But in this moment and in this place, they're right there where their enemies are going to see or at least hear about what they're doing. I mean, doctors today, when this happens with babies, they don't even let parents watch today, much less the enemy. You want us to do what? In front of who? This doesn't seem like good timing or good strategy to defeat the enemy, but God chose this time for the Israelites to do this. And you got to ask the question, why? Why on the enemy side of the river? Why not when they were babies, or at least on the other side of the river? And why, in full view of all of their enemies, are they having to do this? Well, the answer to this question is found when we understand what circumcision actually means in the Bible. Today, many people do it for cultural reasons, and some will argue a medical reason, but the reason in the Bible is different. Here's what circumcision means in Scripture. The first time that it's mentioned is all the way back in Genesis chapter 17. After God has made a covenant with Abraham, and this was a sign of that covenant, that agreement with Abraham. It was more than just a physical thing. God was using this to show as a physical symbol a spiritual reality. God always intended for this to go deeper than a physical act. God spoke to them the spiritual element often. Look in the Old Testament. It says it multiple times. I'll give you just two or three examples. Deuteronomy 10:16. This is what God says. Circumcise, therefore, the foreskin of your, what? Your heart. And be no longer stubborn. You obviously can't circumcise your heart. This was a spiritual reality that God was pointing to. Look at Deuteronomy 30. It says, and the Lord your God will circumcise your, what? Your heart. And the heart of your offspring, so that you will love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, that you may live. Jeremiah 4 says to circumcise yourselves and your hearts for the Lord. The idea was that this was a physical representation of a spiritual heart issue, where God was saying, if you will cut off what is hindering you in your hearts, then you won't be stubborn, then you'll listen to me, then you'll love me more, then you'll follow me more closely. The New Testament talks about it too. In Romans chapter 2, verse 29, it says circumcision is a matter of the what? Heart. By the Spirit. Circumcision is a physical sign of a spiritual work. So God wasn't asking the Israelites to do something that was going to strategically help their military prepare, probably quite the opposite. He wasn't having them do something to train their warriors or to gain some unique, surprising advantage on the battlefield. So why here and why now? Well, when you read your Bible, anytime you've got a question about what is God trying to say or why is he doing it this way, you've got one thing you need to do. If you're curious about something, you know the best thing to do? Keep reading. Look at verse 8. It says, when the circumcising of the whole nation was finished, they remained in their places in the camp until they were healed. Verse 9 says, and the Lord said to Joshua, here it is, you ready? Today I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. And so the name of that place is called Gilgal, which means to roll away, to this day. The very first step for the Jewish people to defeat their enemy wasn't to attack the enemy outside of them. It was to defeat the enemy that remained inside of them. That was the first step. You think about it. These were the Israelites. These were God's chosen people. They were headed into this land to defeat the Canaanites, all the while Egypt still lived inside of them. God wanted them wholly and personally set apart for them. Here's the truth. Before a believer can take the knife to the enemy, he first has to cut out anything in himself that shouldn't be there. And God has them do it at this time. While they're at risk, while the enemy is watching, while they seem to have other seemingly better earthly options, God has them do it now, face to face with their enemies. And I think for many reasons. One, to prepare them for the overt obedience they're going to need. Two, to show them that any defeat over the enemy is God's and not theirs. See, I find when I have a strategic advantage and I think I know what to do next, that is when I am most at risk. The Israelites had become spiritually apathetic while living comfortably in the wilderness. They stopped circumcising their children as God had commanded, and thus they started to look too much like the world around them. Now, rest assured, God still kept his promises. God protected them. God led them. God provided for them. He did all of these things. But in facing their enemies here now, they're moving into a new territory and in a new place. They're taking ground that has been held by the enemy for a long time. And these enemies have plagued them literally for centuries in confronting these barriers that had kept them from experiencing real life the way God designed it and desired it for them. They're confronting all of these things. And the path to defeating those enemies and taking new ground didn't run through their hands or their swords or their mouths. It took a beeline through their hearts. And I believe that God has the Israelites do it at this time not to demoralize them, not to humiliate them, not to scare them, but to set them apart. They wouldn't be like every other nation. They would be different, set apart as holy by God, as his chosen people. And by doing this as grown adults in a risky situation with all the mojo going their way, they showed a willingness to be radically obedient, a radical obedience they're going to need in chapter 6 when God says, walk around the city, blow some trumpets and yell, and that's how we're going to win. Being obedient in this way was preparation for that way. And so as we move forward through the book of Joshua, there's going to be a lot of conquest. There's going to be a lot of military action that's exciting and riveting. There's going to be sword wielding and standing up to the godless culture around them, just as we are called to stand up to the godless culture around us. But I fear too often we think that is our primary agenda and tactic in this world. And we think it's our only battle that we must fight. We know God is going to be victorious over the enemy. We know that he's on our side as believers. And so we thrust headlong into the battle, waging war with the weapons of the world and all the while overlooking the problems that are in our own hearts. You need to know that revival and victory doesn't start without, it starts within. And I'm going to dig a little bit deeper here for you. I believe too long we've thought that we can conquer the enemy that we face in our world while ignoring the decay that's within. I wonder how often we blame all of our problems on the enemy outside when the problem is inside. The Israelites in Joshua 5 aren't the only examples of this, lest you think I've plucked this just from this chapter. If you fast forward a few hundred years, you find the great King David. And ironically, much of his life, he is spent leading a military against many of the same enemies and nations that existed in Joshua 5. Because, spoiler alert, the Israelites are going to struggle with allowing sin inside the camp their entire history while they fight the enemy and they allows the enemy to stay around. And that's not how God designed it or desired it for us. Those verses that we read in the New Testament are true. He is destroyed. He is triumphed. God doesn't want that. He wants freedom for us, wants us to find freedom in this life. He doesn't want us living with the same enemies for hundreds of years. But David is out fighting these same enemies, and here's what happens. He himself sins pretty grievously. You probably know the story. He sleeps with a woman who's not his wife. She gets pregnant. To try to cover it up, he has her husband killed. And then Nathan, a prophet that God sends, comes to confront David and tell him about his sin and what has happened, how he's fighting these enemies without while he's got sin within. And the result of this underlying sin in David's life is that his successes against the external enemies was lessened. And David himself suffered humiliation, shame, and loss. And fighting battles against external enemies while overlooking internal ones ends up in the same results for us. Humiliation, shame, and loss. So how did David respond? It's captured in Psalm 51, great chapter in Scripture. Great book, great chapter in Scripture. Psalm 51, it says the middle verse here of the 19 verses in the chapter, it says in verse 10, David cried out after Nathan came to him, God, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. I want you to notice that David's plea and prayer wasn't that he would go out and fix these problems, but that God would do it within him. Because if we are going to have a circumcision of the heart before we go to the enemy, God is the one who's going to have to reveal it to us and going to be the one that takes care of it in our lives. And the hope and the joy here is that after this moment, David is called a man after God's own heart. Not because he didn't ever do anything wrong or because he was perfect or because he was spotless, but because of how he responded when he found out something was wrong. And so today, before we can get to Jericho's walls, we have to do some internal inspections to see if anything needs to be removed. Practically in our lives, it looks like this. We shouldn't spend more time in prayer against the enemy than we do in praying that God would reveal any remnant of the enemy in us. And we shouldn't spend more time arguing against the enemy than we spend agreeing with what God says about us in our lives. Joshua is full of examples of God defeating enemies in unorthodox ways. And it may seem crazy when we're assured of victory. The enemy knows it, we know it, to turn the proverbial knife on ourselves. But this is God's first step in defeating all those external enemies, is a people set apart for him, by him, that they would say, God, create in us a clean heart. I don't want to spend all of my time fighting external enemies while I'm decaying and wasting away on the inside. God has called us to be a set-apart people, a people who are different. Imagine if the Israelites had come in and conquered the enemy and they had just been the exact same as all those enemies that were there before them. Well, maybe you can, unfortunately. God has called us to be different. But lest we think we've got a better plan, the best example of somebody who chose fleshly death in order to bring victory is who? It's Jesus himself. Look at 1 Peter 2:24. He himself, Jesus, bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. God has been bringing victory in unorthodox, backwards, non-human ways forever. Jesus, face to face with the enemy on the tree. You think the Canaanites' hearts melted away? Jesus had control of legions of angels. He could have defeated everyone that was persecuting him and killing him. He could have wiped them out with a snap of a finger or a blink of an eye, yet he chose not to. Victory was going to happen for sure, for certain. And you and I are beneficiaries of that. But first, there was a heart issue that had to be taken care of. I want to invite you to bow your heads with me for a moment. And here's what we're going to do. I just think Joshua 5, what God is calling us to do is pray that prayer that David prayed in Psalm 51. God, create in me a clean heart. Renew a right spirit within me. If you're a believer here today, Holy Spirit living inside of you, the helper, the one who reminds you of what God has said and who you are in him. Ask him, God, help me see what I don't see. Search me. Know me. See if there be any offensive way in me. And lead me in your way forevermore. God, I pray if there is a dark corner of my heart that I have closed off to you, I pray that you'd open the door and show me right now. If there is some sin I've become comfortable with that you want to cut out of my life, I pray that I wouldn't be so focused on those that I think are worse than me that I miss the fact that I'm decaying and have this inside of me. Help me to cut it out of my life, Lord. Whatever it is, reveal it to us now, Lord. We want to be a people who are set apart by you and for you. We want to be a people who are different than the enemy around us. God, make us clean. Make us new. Make us whole. Help us to experience the freedom that you died on the cross to give us. Help us to live in that freedom. As we walk in this dark world, help our light shine brighter. Help our lives be holier because of what you're doing inside of us. If you're not a believer here today, the only way to experience that real freedom is by accepting what Jesus did and dying on the cross and allowing his flesh to die so that you may live. He took your sins on himself on the cross, paying your penalty, your price, your debt that we couldn't pay so that you would be saved. And if you've never cried out and asked him to save you, it's his desire. He is willing that none should perish, but that all should reach repentance. You cry out now, God, I can't do it on my own. In your own words, as God is listening to you, I can't do it on my own. I repent, which means I turn around. I turn back to you. I know only you can save me. I confess Jesus is Lord. He is my Lord. I believe that he died on the cross for me and that he rose again. Come into my life and save me. Make me whole. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, as believers, I believe we need to pray every day. Create in me a clean heart today, O God. Help me to be set apart and different today for you and by you. But if you're here today and you made a decision to follow Jesus for the first time, we'd love to celebrate with you. We'd love to be able to help walk you through that decision and what next steps there are. And one of those next steps is to be baptized. If you accepted Christ today and asked him to be your Savior, we'd love to baptize you. Pastor Kevin's right there. And in just a second, we're going to stand and worship together, and we've got everything you need. You can be baptized, or if you've just never been baptized, he wants you to be set apart, which the first step is being obedient and saying yes to baptism. So be baptized today. Don't wait any longer. And if you're a believer here today, I want to show you something. What happens in Joshua 5, the very next verse in verse 10, what they do. It says, while the people of Israel were encamped at Gilgal, they kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month in the evening on the plains of Jericho. Now, you remember the story of Passover is when the lamb was killed to put on their doorposts, kind of in the shape of a cross, to help death pass over their house. The lamb was slaughtered so that death would pass over their house. And it is clearly a picture of Jesus, who died on a cross, whose blood was shed so that death would pass over us. So right after they went through this heart cleansing, circumcision, they kept Passover, remembering how God had saved them from death. And so we're going to do the same thing. We're going to take communion, saying thank you to Jesus for securing our freedom by dying on a cross for us. And if you're a believer, you take the bread and the juice, remembering that body and that blood that was broken and spilled for you. Pray and thank him for it. Take it when you're ready, and we'll stand and we'll worship together in just a moment.
Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. Oh Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. Oh Spirit, come make us humble.
That is the cry of your heart today as you go, is God, clean us, make us like yourself, set us apart so we go out into this world. We are a bright light in the midst of darkness. I want to thank you for coming to worship today. Thank you for being a people who loves God's word, wants to dig in and learn it so that we know him better. That's our heart for you, that you would know God. And while I know that each one of us have steps we need to take in our walk with the Lord, we call them next steps around here, and it's our job to help you take next steps to experience that abundant life that God has called us to go into the promised land to live. And right on cue, so good on the timing, Megan is our next steps person. And look at this. This is good. We did not coordinate that. This is Megan, and we'd love to help you take those next steps, whatever they are. So stop by over there, see her. And this, it can be next steps with our church, yes, or just next steps for you personally. If you're saying, man, I need help cleaning up. I need help, you know, cutting things out of my heart, my life that I know I don't need. We've got ways to help you and ministries that can help you do that. And it's our heart to help you take that next step. Thank you for giving. We told you last week about us partnering to launch a new church in Lovettsville, Lovettsville Baptist Church, and that is full steam ahead in September. And so I just wanted to say thank you again for those of you who weren't here last week for putting us in a position where we can step out and make a difference in this county in such a tangible way. We believe that God has called us to be a church in our community for the community. I joke about, you know, Grudos and places like that in my sermons a lot because I love Purcellville, and I love Western Loudoun. God has put us here, and it is our charge to make a difference right here. And to that end, we know that how that's going to happen is God uniting our church in relationship with one another. I asked a few weeks ago how many of you were new in the last year. God has brought a bunch of new people to our church, and we're excited about that. But church is a place where people know each other. And so to that end, the word community kind of goes two ways, right? It's there's a community of people, and then there's a community that we're in. And so what we are doing is, as you leave today, you're going to get this card that says Better Together. Quotes Proverbs 27:9, a sweet friendship refreshes the soul. And in my love for all things ice cream and Grudos, here's how it works. Is our challenge to you is sometime in the next 7 days between July 11th and July 18th, we want you to grab one more family in our church or one of your neighbors or somebody who doesn't go to church, just your family or you and another person. It doesn't have to be a family. If you're a single or a young person, grab somebody else and go get ice cream at a local ice cream place. So this is a community for the community, right? So the three places are Grudos, Sweet Frog, and Tipped Cow. And here's how it works is that if you take this card with you, you'll get $10 of free ice cream at any of those places, okay? And so we want to equip you with that because we believe God has called us to unite together as people in a church. He's also called us to make a difference out there. So grab one of these cards as you go. And is there anything better in the middle of the summer than a good bowl of ice cream? I don't know if there is, okay? So grab this, find somebody this week, anytime this week, do that. And we'd love to see your pictures. We've got a hashtag you can use and stuff to see how we're spreading out into the community for the love of the Lord, for the love of other people, and for the love of ice cream. All right? So we're going to send you out with that. God, I thank you for each person that's here. I thank you that you have made us a community of believers to love your word, to love you, and to know you better, and to walk in freedom and to be set apart. And I thank you that you put us in this community. So help us to go out, not just to get ice cream, but into our workplaces. Help us to go out into our teams and into our neighborhoods and wherever we are, and to be set apart people who are living for you as missionaries in our homes and in all of those places. Use us this week, Lord, and I can't wait to be back together with these people next week. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.